we'll bring the camera up here. I'm just admiring.
We got new flowers.
We never get new flowers. Not that I really pay attention to flowers. I'm trying to pull back my card here.
Sure you do.
We got brand new flowers on the weekends, which we never get. We only get the old flowers from the week.
I think Geraldo Rivera. Geraldo Rivera is joining us, and so he wanted flowers. Geraldo,
good morning.
Thank you so much for sending these beautiful flowers.
Good morning.
Hi, Geraldo.
I sent him to Lisa, not to you.
Thank you. Happy
New Year, everybody. Wanted to brighten up the joint a bit.
Of course. Happy New Year.
Listen, we've got to get right to this story. Really remarkable today. The president at Camp David to talk about all the important things he's got to get done for the country, but yet taking a moment through Twitter, through his medium that he has spoken directly to a segment of this country that was sick of what was going on in Washington, inside Washington swamp, as he calls it, calling him mentally unfit. It is becoming a chorus because of this book written by a gossip journalist. But the president all morning long absolutely pushing back, as we've been talking, against these challenges that he is unfit somehow mentally. Let us just read one of them on the air real quick, Geraldo. And that's this one. Now that Russian collusion after 1 year of intense study has proven to be a total hoax on the American public, the Democrats and their lapdogs, the fake news mainstream media, are taking out the old Ronald Reagan playbook and screaming mental stability and intelligence. Actually, throughout my life, my two greatest assets have been mental stability and being like really smart. Crooked Hillary Clinton also played these cards very hard and, as everyone knows, went down in flames. I went from very successful businessman to top TV star to president of the United States. On my first try, he notes, I think that would qualify as not smart, but genius, and a very stable genius at that. Geraldo, your thoughts?
Well, I spoke with the president yesterday, and it was in line with the tweets that he sent out this morning. He's extremely frustrated as a very smart person, someone I've known for 40 years, someone who graduated with honors from Wharton School of Business at the University of Pennsylvania, a person who built a multi-billion dollar business and who did attain the highest office in the world on his first attempt. He is very, very frustrated that this line is getting any traction. It really is getting traction. Back to your point, Griff, about the Russian collusion. As the Russia controversy and the collusion, allegations fade with the lack of proof of anything meaningful having happened, there seems to be, and the president's frustrated about it, a grasping for something to nail him on, something to criticize mm-hmm. him for. And they've seized on this absolutely absurd, mental capacity. And the thing that is so very, very frustrating to him, and I think it should be to the entire country, is that Michael Wolff can make statements in this book like 100% of the people around the president think he lacks the emotional and intellectual capacity to hold the job. How could 100% of his own family and friends? It's absolutely ridiculous.
We have that sound to your point. Take a listen to Michael Wolff.
According to your reporting, everyone around the president, senior advisors, family members, every single one of them questions his intelligence and fitness for office.
100% of the people around him. He's like a pinball, just shooting off the sides.
100%, Geraldo.
It is absolutely outrageous. 100% of his family. So here's an author who claims that somebody in the inner circle called Ivanka dumb as a brick. So he's attacking the children, he's attacking the family, and then now he's saying that those very same family members that he is attacking believe the president is unfit for office. It is so frustrating. It is so intellectually dishonest. You know, they are now, the investigative reporters I saw in the Washington Post last night, are looking at that book page by page.
Of course.
In one single page, they found three errors, three very important factual errors in a single page. And as they go through, they'll find dozens and scores more. At what point, after finding all those errors, do you begin to question the basic premise of the book? And I think Geraldo, we would all be well advised to do that.
And staying on that topic, Geraldo, because, you know, you've been a journalist for, decades here, and we've seen some massive missteps as of late with ABC, CNN, as you just mentioned, there's already been numerous parts of this book that have been debunked and proven to be untrue. Do you worry about the profession?
You know, I really do. Like Brian Ross, I think, is a terrific reporter, one of the a true great investigators. The problem comes when you watch these people at work, particularly some of the other cable news networks. You see that they are so far down the road toward condemning this president as reckless and incompetent that there is no fact. There is no revelation that will sway them from that course. They are committed now to seeing the destruction or the ridicule of the 45th president. They are so invested emotionally, morally, professionally, that they just can't turn around. Sure. Even as there's the first criminal referral in the Russiagate probe. And who is it? It's Christopher Steele, the author of the dossier, who Senators Grassley and Graham have now referred to the DOJ for a criminal probe.
Yeah.
You know, let's get real here and give this person, the president of the United States, a break. Treat him as fairly as you treat anybody else.
You're talking about fair reporting. One of those outlets that had a headline that caught our eye recently is Newsweek. It used to be a publication and then it wasn't making money, so now it's only online. Here's the full screen of what the publication actually had to say. Trump impeachment odds have risen thanks to fire and fury. Is this not the real underlying desire of the left and of their lapdogs in the media? They want to build a case. It was collusion. Now it's obstruction. Now it's mental incompetence. Aren't they looking for any shred they can?
Well, absolutely, Pete. And you have a situation where you want to get the guy. You want to cripple him. You want to weaken him. You don't like his policies. You don't like where he stands on immigration or Muslim refugees. So you pick the topic with which you disagree with the president. So what do you do as the remedy? Do you propose an alternate policy, a situation or alternative for the president? You're going to be the other side to the president? No, what you do is you attack his basic character, his emotional and mental fitness. The president was so bright and smart and on point to invoke the way people were slandering Ronald Reagan toward the end of his presidency as being mentally unfit, having incapacity, talking about the 25th Amendment to replace him temporarily when he recovers
his
emotional state. I hope not, Lisa, but when you keep having this erosion, it's just like salt water hitting a pier. It doesn't have an immediate effect, but over time they're hoping that it rots and the pier collapses. It's not going to happen. Look at the economy. Look at what's happening to the country. Yeah. Look at domestically in an objective appraisal of how we are doing. I think we're doing just fine, and I think this president is spot on point. But as long as this noise exists, as these attacks persist, that's what people will be focused on.
You know a lot about water hitting peers. You know, you talk about these attacks. President Trump, as I started asking you in the beginning of this, he's using Twitter to absolutely push back, full on frontal pushback. And, Twitter, there's a story out there that we've been talking about a little bit. I don't know if the president talked about this when you spoke with him, but Twitter, there's calls for Twitter to ban the president's Twitter handle. I need to put up quickly a statement from Twitter where they say blocking a world leader from Twitter or removing their controversial tweets would hide important information people should be able to see and debate. It would also not silence that leader, but it would certainly hamper necessary discussion around their words and actions. Calls to ban the president's Twitter. Did he bring this up with you?
No, he didn't speak about his Twittering it, which I think and have written is sometimes impetuous and counterproductive. I think the president in the big picture, Griff, and then I'll get back to Twitter specifically. In the big picture, the president is frustrated and he wants to get his message out. And he understands that his perhaps overreaction to the publication of the Michael Wolff book with the cease and desist threats and so forth added more fuel to the fire that attracted more attention, as it often does, to the controversy, then perhaps he should have gone down that road. But in terms of Twitter, as I use the word impetuous, I think that's a better word than reckless. As impetuous as the president sometimes can be on Twitter, emotional and spontaneous, I believe that that is a very, very effective method for him to speak directly to the people of the United States and to the world writ large, where he gets it out in an unfiltered way. 90% of them are spot on. Sometimes he goes, a tweet too far. But those early morning, you wake up, you're, oh, okay, well, how can that person say this about me? But I really do believe that he has honed social media to one of the most effective direct communications. It's not through our filter. It's the president directly to the people, the American people and to the audience and to the foreign leaders with which he has a beef. Look at the North Korean situation. His tweets about Rocket Man and Fire and Fury and all the rest of those kinds of statements. What's the bottom line? The bottom line is that North Korea, rather than being repelled and becoming more aggressive and more reckless in their foreign policy, shooting off more nukes and having military drills, what's happened instead is that North Korea, hearing from the president of the United States about don't you dare, has now opened talks with South Korea. Yeah. Now they're cooperating on the Olympics and other things. So the president's point, and this is a point that he did make, is look at what he has accomplished in terms of his deeds, not these words. Words, when provoked in the president, I've learned 40 years, I understand how he can react and sometimes overreact. But look at what he's done in terms of what the measured steps he has taken in office, so totally within the bounds of a moderate Republican conservative president. But I think that he's totally traditional in what he does rather than what he sometimes says.
That's interesting, but they can't, everyone else can't handle the different take he has and outside the box way in which he conducts himself, and that drives him crazy, so they react to that. Geraldo Rivera, thank you very much for joining us.
Great points, Geraldo.
Thanks for joining. Thank you for the flowers.
Okay. Yes. That's right.
Oh, my pleasure, Lisa. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. All right. Still ahead. He's the author of the infamous Dirty Trump dossier, and now Congress wants the DOJ to investigate him. Are criminal charges next for Christopher Steele? We'll ask Florida Congressman Ron DeSantis.
And the NFL's ratings take a huge hit after protests dominate the regular season. So has the league finally learned its lesson? Well, the man who killed Osama bin Laden, Rob O'Neill, I saw him in the green room. He's looking dapper, and he's ready to respond. Welcome back. Well, two GOP senators calling on the Justice Department to open a criminal investigation into Christopher Steele. You remember he's the author of the controversial and poorly sourced Trump dossier.
Senators Chuck Grassley and Lindsey Graham referring Steele to the Justice Department, saying there are potential violations regarding inconsistencies he made in statements provided to authorities.
And here with reaction is GOP Florida Congressman and Florida gubernatorial candidate Ron DeSantis. Hi, Congressman.
Good morning. You guys must be cold up there because it is cold in Central Florida.
Oh, it is very, very cold outside.
We don't feel bad for you. You're in Florida. It'll be fine soon.
Well, so... go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, first off, what's your response to this referral by Senator Grassley and Senator Graham?
I think it's significant. I mean, we don't know exactly which statements, because they had a classified attachment, basically, that was provided to Ray and Rosenstein. They're working to declassify or redact any sensitive stuff so that could be made public, which I think that they should do. But this all goes to... how did this investigation into this collusion begin with law enforcement? What was Christopher Steele's role? Who was he working with in the Justice Department or the FBI? People like Bruce Orr, who was a high Justice Department official and whose wife worked for Fusion GPS, who commissioned Steele to do the dossier. And I think the issue could be that on the one hand, we know this was paid for by the Democratic Party. It was effectively discredited opposition research, but it was actively being shopped to all these media outlets during the campaign. And as anti-Trump as almost all media outlets were, none of them bid on it.
That's a great point.
Yet at the same time, it's very possible, and I think we're going to get these answers definitively very soon, that while the media was rejecting printing this stuff, that information from that dossier was actually used to get a surveillance warrant at a FISA court against an American citizen associated with Trump's campaign. So I think this is significant because it's going to tell us more information about the dossier.
Congressman, of course, the inference there that FISA warrant then led to ultimately the Mueller investigation. But I want to ask you specifically, Senator Dianne Feinstein, the top Democrat on the Judiciary Committee, said there's nothing to this. This is just a distraction to the larger Mueller investigation.
Well, we've been hearing things like that ever since we learned several months ago, how this dossier was created, that it was a political opposition research. We didn't know that before. Now we know, and that's because of people like Devin Nunes and others in the House who've been demanding these answers. Fusion GPS didn't want to admit this. They had to be subpoenaed. You had people with Fusion take the fifth. So now people realize the dossier is an issue, and everybody is trying to minimize it who has been furthering this Trump-Russia narrative. We're going to get the 100% truth on this very shortly, and there's nothing I've seen that leads me to believe that it's going to be anything other than something that's very troubling.
And you know, if you think about it, this goes from an investigation into so-called Russian collusion into now what has turned into investigation into collusion on the Democratic side to take down President Trump. You say we'll know soon. I think a lot of the American people feel like, man, it's been a year. You know, I've been hearing about Russia, Russia, Russia. How soon and when could all of this wrap up and we identify and get to the bottom?
So finally, the FBI and DOJ has met the deadline that Congress imposed. That stuff's going to be provided this coming week. And I don't know how much it is, but obviously people are going to be going through that, particularly on the Intelligence Committee. And so I think the answers about the dossier, I think the answers about the surveillance, I think all that is going to be in Congress's hands very, very soon. And then the question is, if there's accountability that needs to happen, it needs to go. And people like Jeff Sessions have to be engaged in that. If you have an FBI agent who is misusing his authority because he wanted to stop Donald Trump from being president, we need to know that, and that person needs to be held accountable.
And Congressman, we have to go. Thank you so much, and good luck on that gubernatorial race down there. We look forward to hearing more about how that's going. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. Thanks, guys.
All right. Should people who get unemployment benefits be drug tested first? The Trump administration could make it happen. We'll debate it next.
And brand new signs this morning. Kim Jong-un could be going for gold. He's on a horse. Thankfully, his shirt is on, unlike Vladimir Putin. We'll bring that to you next.
Giddy up.
Welcome back to Fox and Friends on this Saturday morning. Thanks for being here. Some news by the numbers for you. First, one Democrat. That's Congressman Earl Blumenauer of Oregon. The first, probably not the last, to announce that he will boycott President Trump's State of the Union address on January 30th. Instead, he says he'll work from home. That's what we all say we're going to do when we stay home. Next, 30,200. That's how many travelers' cell phones were searched by Border Patrol agents in 2017. That number jumping more than 60% since the year before. This is Homeland Security issues tighter limitations on border searches for smartphones and tablets. Finally, 93 below. It's the last observed wind chill on Mount Washington in New Hampshire. The air temperature 37 below with wind gusts of up to 100 miles an hour. Kids, we're climbing Mount Washington. Put on an extra pair of gloves. That's chilly. Lisa, over to you.
Thanks, Pete. And the Trump administration is looking to bring back and expand on a rule that Congress repealed last year requiring drug testing for unemployment benefits. This is unemployment benefits or benefits claims are at a 17-year record low, decreasing by thousands during Trump's first year in office. So what does this mean for taxpayers and those looking to hire new employees? Here to debate it is Republican strategist Chris Prudhomme and former candidate for DNC chair Jamu Green. Hey, guys. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having
me. So Jamu, unemployment benefits are meant to serve as a hand up to help get someone to a place until they're gainfully employed. Isn't making sure someone's not on drugs a good place to start?
Well, I think that we need to look at what the results of the similar policies that states that have passed these policies across the country have found. And the evidence is just not there, Lisa.
But what's wrong with it on its face, though? Would you have an issue with making sure that, you know, taxpayers aren't supporting individuals who are on drugs or making it somehow contingent on ensuring that someone's not on drugs? What's wrong with it on its face?
It's not smart policy.
Why not?
And we have the evidence from that. In this world of like polarized politics that we're living in, I get when everything falls on a partisan level, but this is an area where we actually have results from many states that have implemented these policies. And what we've learned is you don't save money. The population that you're actually testing has a lower drug usage rate than the rest of the country. And so what exactly is the point here? Are we drug testing, you know, industries that get subsidies? Are we drug testing, you know, any company that gets tax credits? I do think there's also a discriminatory aspect of this here.
But
when it comes down to it, it's just not smart policy.
Chris, I want to get you in on here. Is it smart policy? What do you say to Jamil?
So what's not smart policy is allowing children to grow up and see opportunities limited in their families. Grow up, obviously, looking at drugs. These children should be able to grow up in prosperous environments, knowing that they can do whatever they are able to do, be in environments of prosperity. This is why it doesn't matter if it's 10, 5 states, 1 state. This should absolutely be drug tested. Welfare, I'm certainly all for helping those who need help, all for supporting those in times of need, absolutely. But what we have to do is not crutch and not allow people to be on drugs that are on welfare. Any type of drug use is certainly wrong, and you certainly should not be doing it with taxpayers' dollars.
Well, and Jamu, another aspect of this reportedly is the Department of Labor opening it up so more employers or in different industries can test their employees to make sure they're not on drugs. Look, we know that high schoolers for athletes can be tested for drugs, even middle schoolers. What do you make of that? Are you on board with giving employers the ability to test their employees and make sure that they can do their job correctly?
Absolutely. And I think when we look at this issue of whether it is supplemental benefits or unemployment benefits that are being given out simply on a drug test, it comes down to the fact that this population, to hear all of the conversation about making sure that they're not using drugs, seems to indicate that there's a larger problem within this community with drug usage. And that's just not the case. We know we are facing a huge drug crisis in this country. And to single out one portion of the population
Hold on, Jamil. I want to get Chris in here because we're running out of time. But it's not just that population, Chris. As I mentioned, there are numerous professions that require drug testing.
That's
middle
right.
school athletes and high school athletes can be tested for drugs.
That's right.
So, I mean, what do you make of what Jamu just said?
So look, here's the thing. You have to go to work and earn money and be drug tested. So if you're going to get free money from the taxpayers, you should absolutely be drug tested. This is absolutely ridiculous.
It has nothing to do with
being discriminated against. It has nothing to do with classes, cultures. I don't care if you're black, white, green. It does not matter. What's wrong is wrong. Drug usage is wrong. You should not be using taxpayers' dollars to do it. It's time for people to start taking responsibility for themselves and start being more engaged in prosperous lives. This is about building up a country and a nation of people that can be prosperous. And you cannot be prosperous as a child if you're seeing your environment around you with violence, domestic issues, and drug uses.
We're going to have to end it there because we're running out of time. Thank you both. We really appreciate you joining us this morning.
Thanks, Lisa.
Have a great day. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Well, Fixer Upper stars Chip and Joanna Gaines just announced they are expecting their fifth child. This is so cute. I love this. So why are they being bullied on social media for the news? Plus, here we go again. An ESPN host attacking President Trump and not holding back. Take a listen.
So Trump always does this in his thing, so...
That's because he's a stupid person.
Well, what do you think her punishment was? A slap on the wrist. Rob O'Neill, the man who killed Osama bin Laden. Oh, my Lord. Here to react. Stay tuned. As Pete tackles him.
Out of nowhere.
Keep him on his toes.
Wow.
What's your biggest military concern for this year?
I don't think I have any. I don't have concerns. I create them.
and yet another amazing quote from James Mattis. Well, we've got Rob O'Neill here, the Navy SEAL who killed bin Laden, author of The Operator and Fox News contributor. He's a quotable guy that the troops love. Talk to us about that.
They absolutely love him. He's one of the few people that actually is serving, leading at war, and there are quotes on the wall about him. I've seen General Mattis and probably General Stan McChrystal. That's pretty much about it. You're serving with people you know are destined for greatness.
And that's the ethos you want. You want confidence. You want the belief that, you know, we're not worried about folks. We keep people up at night.
That's exactly what it is, too. General Mattis is one of the people, too, that you would actually get in trouble for not killing enough of the enemy. Wasn't that a big worry about political correct rules of engagement? Why didn't you kill more of them?
How much do our enemies fear him?
I don't think enough. I don't think you can fear him enough.
Yeah.
He's a very serious guy. He's one of the people that is like, well, why aren't you married? Well, if I was going to get married, the Marine Corps would have issued me a wife. Type
thing. That's his service. Didn't he say to show up and have a plan to kill everyone?
Yeah.
Hopefully that's not the case here, Rob.
It's one of those things like he carries a knife because he might run into some cake, or he might need to stab someone in the neck.
Right.
That's the kind of, I love the guy.
Well, Rob, let me move on.
I might
on.
Be making that part up.
But let me move to a story here, Terror in the Homeland, and that is, of course, the document show Orlando nightclub shooter's wife knew her husband, Omar Mateen, was going to shoot up Orlando nightclub when he killed 49 people back in 2016. Here you go. You see Omar Mateen. What do you make of this, that the Pulse shooter's wife knew about the attack?
He was showing her the nightclub. This is my target. This is what I'm going to do. She watched him load the magazines for the weapons. She was with him when he was buying the weapons. When he left, he told her what he was going to. She knew everything that he was going to do. This is the one day, is what he said to his wife when he left. She knew it was happening.
Does this surprise you at all?
I mean, not at all. How
complicit are these spouses in these?
I think if they're to the point, that point of jihad, they're just submissive to the husband, which is kind of how they roll. It doesn't excuse her, and she's going to do everything she can, from the religion to post-traumatic stress disorder, whatever. She's going to get charged with this, and she should. She knew this was happening, where it was going to happen, and when.
A dry run, if you will. I mean, she did the dry run.
Yeah, driving him around in the car with him, and she knew exactly what he was doing, what he was up to. It's horrible.
Of course.
49 people dead. And all he said was, how upset do you think people will be after this? Upset? 49 lives.
Yep.
One night.
No, I think common sense tells us if your wife or your husband knows what you're going to do and you mm-hmm. kill 50 people, yeah. you're yeah. almost as guilty as the guy who pulled the trigger.
I think so. Yeah. If you're part of the crime, there's no excuses.
And Rob, I want to get your take on another topic. So we've seen ESPN's Katie Nolan went after President Trump. Take a listen to this, and then we want to get your thoughts.
So Trump always does this in his thing, so...
Back it up. Back it up. That's because he's a stupid person. What happens no when suspension. Companies like ESPN, they don't do anything?
Hold on one second, though. It didn't, just bear with me, because it didn't stop there. Max Kellerman, ESPN's host, also went on as to why the Astros should not accept the White House. Quick listen.
They're making a grave error and are on the wrong side of history. And I want to be very clear about this. This has nothing to do with where on the political spectrum you fall, left or right. Nothing. It's not about being progressive or conservative or Democrat or Republican or winning or losing elections. That's not what this is about. I say what I say because what has gone on in this administration is abnormal and must not be normalized. You do not normalize this behavior with White House visits, period.
Am I watching ESPN or MSNBC?
Right.
Should ESPN normalize behavior, though?
They can't help themselves. There's so much coming to my mind right now. Yeah, it is abnormal because the Dow's above 25,000. That's abnormal. And guess what? It's going to be a record for a few days because on Monday it's going to be higher. They're making such a... It doesn't matter who's in the office. You respect the White House. That's what it is. When you get invited to the White House, you respect the office. It doesn't, I served under President Clinton, President Bush, President Obama, and it should be country first. For some reason, they're politicizing everything about this. The Astros should go to the White House when they're invited. And, mm-hmm. and on the other side, too, I think President Trump should take the advantage to extend the olive branch and maybe try to bring people together. But you have this ridiculous stuff. The thing with Katie Nolan, she's making a name for herself. She's not suspended yet. What she actually said is that was bleeped out was a slur. She insulted handicapped people, and they'll be able to read her lips what she actually said the first time when she corrected herself by saying the F word and something else. The thing I have about her, though, is not so much talking bad about President Trump or the White House. She badmouthed Tom Brady. She called him. I'm just saying, regardless of the kneeling and all that stuff, I'm a football fan. You win 5 Super Bowls. You run a team that Brady has. He's not an idiot.
So this is a double whammy for you.
Yeah.
Going after Tom Brady and the president.
I'm a Redskins fan, but you start bad enough.
Yes. Redskins are stellar 9-8. And that brings up, we talked earlier and we've talked a lot about things here, but the drop in the NFL ratings, do you think that this stuff happening on ESPN really cuts in the fact, as Pete was saying earlier, that people just want to watch the game?
They do, and they don't want to hear what someone on ESPN says about politics. They're not interested in what they have to say. I mean, there's successful people over there, but just keep politics out of it. Talk about the sport. And in the NFL, you're seeing bad leadership. Look what MLB did during the World Series. They brought some police officers from LA. They sang the national anthem. Everyone standing up because they require it. Not a big deal. The NFL, Goodell's not doing a good job. No. I think Barstool Sports is doing a great job kind of hammering him. We'll see. He was good enough to give himself a monster raise. Horrible leadership in the NFL.
All right, so, Rob, you're all over the map in the NFL. You're defending Tom Brady. You're a Redskins fan. You were also in my home state. Hold on. Yeah, you were in my home state blowing the horn for the Minnesota Vikings. You are now a Vikings fan.
I tell you what, I'm picking the Vikings this year.
Watch this. This is Rob O'Neill kicking off the game. Like a bucket list light bulb. How cool is that?
That was so cool doing that. What was neat too is that video you're watching right there, my wife, that's on her phone.
Yeah.
Okay. And we were both nervous because my friend Tim Montana was singing his band acapella, the national anthem. Not a single player there, either team, took a knee. The Vikings haven't taken a knee at all.
Not once. That's got to be who you're playing for in the playoffs.
Big time. And I'm all Vikings this year. I think they're going to take it.
They told you that if they make it, you're coming with.
Hopefully. Well, I'm saying playoffs. They got to buy this week. Well, yeah, but I wouldn't mind going out there for the game.
And you have a relationship with the tight end, Kyle Rudolph.
Yeah, Kyle Rudolph. He and I had a chance to speak. I spoke to the team after speaking to 9/11 families right before I spoke to the Vikings. Mm-hmm. We talked about, I don't want to ruin it, but just how to kind of suck it up, get out there and do it. And it'll pain his temporary prides forever.
If the Vikings win, I have you to thank. If Rob O'Neill and Lou Holtz like the Vikings this year, and they're not kneeling, it's got to be our year. I'm telling you.
And they have a chance to be the first team in NFL history to play the Super Bowl at home.
I know.
And that stadium's awesome. You know that stadium's shaped like a Viking ship?
Of course.
Yeah.
Drive by it all the time. It looks like a Viking ship.
And there's something about in front of 75,000 people doing a skull chant.
How did you feel?
Oh my goodness.
That's
it felt like
cool.
like a Nordic
that
god.
That was awesome. Yeah. That is the best video of the day.
Rob O'Neill.
Thanks,
Rob.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Rob.
All right, well, the stock market booming to start the new year, ending the week with an all-time high, as Rob pointed out, yet again. So why are some of the media hoping the surge comes to an end? I wonder why.
Plus, was your New Year's resolution to go on a diet? So which ones really work and which ones are just fads? We've got an expert to serve up the truth. That's coming up. I wonder what